Hello, malty, morning malt monkeys. Yeah, and that malt mention introducing this whisky review 332 is from star 12121 and is a little tribute to Davy Jones of the Monkees. You confused about that at all, malt mates? Well, just put in Davy Jones Monkees on YouTube and then you'll find out all about it and learn about the Monkees. Classic group, classic group. And got a little bit a very easy link there into a classic group to a classic malt. One of the quieter classics. It's not heavily marketed, it's not boasted about, it's an independent bottling of a kind of reasonably iconic single malt. And the first time here at Ralphie.com that I have reviewed Longmorn single malt whisky from Scotland. This is an independent bottling from Gordon and Macphail, who are one of Scotland's largest independent bottlers. And if it wasn't for the independent bottlers bottling Longmorn single malt, we would be seriously struggling to get any good examples of what is quite a fantastic whisky. There are official bottlings out there, but they are very few and far between and rather limited. In the 1990s, there was a 15-year-old Longmorn, which is the one that I recommend you look out for. This was replaced in the 2000s by a 16-year-old Longmorn in a far more designer bottle, but the contents were just not as good. And unfortunately, and it's just an opinion, just a Ralphie opinion, really didn't do Longmorn any favours. I don't suppose the producers really have to worry too much about Longmorn as a single malt, because the majority of it is used in the Chivas Regal blends, particularly the 18-year-old, where it does a marvellous job of propping up that blended scotch. So you're really looking at for older versions of Longmorn, and it's a malt that ages very well. You're looking at Gordon Macphail, perhaps some signatory bottles. There's Longmorn does feature in quite a range of the independent bottlers, so it's not actually hard to get a hold of. But as always is the case, check out first before you buy. Some versions are superb, some versions are good, and some versions are disappointing. It's getting the knowledge which is which. I'm reviewing this one because I recommend it as a particularly successful and fairly consistent version. It's 30 year old, it's bottled at 43%, and very much a sherry matured whisky which suits Longmorn. It's certainly got what is described by experienced whisky fans as an old school yesteryear malt nose. There's a few reasons for that, and I'm going to discuss one reason in particular further on in this vlog. But I'm going to start now with the tasting notes. Incidentally, this is a whisky that if you've got a good budget, then it won't put you too far out of pocket for in terms of the quality of whisky you're getting. If you are on a budget, then this is ideal for the whisky club you're in to buy collectively. So everybody puts in a percentage, you buy this bottle, and then you share it out between yourselves at a whisky club event, and then you can discuss it and see all the different kind of features and flavours that you can pick out in it. What you may well pick out on the nose is a lovely toffeed sherry note, barley sugars, and overripe fruit. Longmorn is a naturally complex single malt. It's rather like one of its neighbours, which is Glenrothes. It's a fairly complex single malt, particularly with age. And these two malts have something in common in that they are considered dressing whiskies by blenders. I shall come back to that shortly. Bananas overripe. You know when bananas turn brown and they start to go off and you get that kind of confectionery banana note? Well, you're getting that. Orange marmalade, vanilla, angelica, touch of apricot, marshmallows, strawberries, overripe apples, damsons, complex warm range of spices, some gingerbread and a hint of mixed peel. So quite a busy whisky this. Certainly one where the character, the still signature of the malt works really well with a sweet old sherry. And of course, at 30 years of age, you're getting the kind of leather notes, tobacco note, slight tobacco note, and a hint of shoe polish. But they're more like really dominated by the slightly overripe fruit nature of the smell. And this comes into the taste as well. 30 years old, 43%. It will not need a lot of water. Rich, intense, but also there's a delicate side to this as well. You're really getting a domination by the cask initially, and it's once you let it sit for a while and then sip as slowly as you can, you'll see how the malt itself comes back again and redresses the balance with the cask. Sweet and sour, brown sugar, touch of Muscovado, old rum notes, developing into a sherry malt, heavy with overripe fresh fruit, including pineapple, banana, apricot, vanilla, honey, sweetened English breakfast tea, and assorted spices. So a nice fusion of a variety, not one particular spice, but a variety of spices, as you would use in a spicy fruitcake, infused with the kind of overripe fruit, almost as if you've got a basket of fruit in a warm room and you realise from the smell of it when you're passing, you know, if I don't hurry up and eat those fruits, they're just going to be going off shortly. That kind of sweet, pungent smell and taste. In the finish, vanilla, dusty leather, some shoe polish, tea and mixed baker's spices. So the age notes tend to kind of pop up in the finish here. That's when they become most prominent, as the overripe fruit and as the spices start to subdue and die down a bit into the fairly long and satisfying finish. So, very much a winter warmer. So, brief notes to conclude. One for slow sipping. I can't emphasise this enough. People rush whiskies too much. I mean, the culture tends to be, if I hurry up with this one, I can then pour another one. But this is one of these whiskies where you put out a glass and you actually, you follow it for the rest of the night, you know, for a few hours. Fair enough, have another whiskey at the side of it, a blend or something. A Chivas 18-year-old would be perfect, because you'll be able to start to make connection. You'll be able to identify this single malt within the character of the 18-year-old blended scotch. Good stuff, very good stuff indeed. A prolonged arrival, a prolonged development, measured and a gently extended finish. A real old school aged malt. And I think there's a particular reason for that, and it's Dunnage Warehouses, that Longmorn as a malt generally comes from old fashioned Dunnage Warehouses rather than modern industrial, so that the length of the event, I think, is that little bit more extended and substantial. Again, that's just an opinion. So here we have a malt mark, and it's quite a high one. It's 93 out of 100, And that is a malt mark. And this is the malt. Now, I mentioned earlier that it's kind of hard to get hold of official bottlings of Longmorn, unfortunately. And one reason, significant reason, is because of the demand for it in the flagship blends, blended scotches of Pernod Ricard, which is Chivas Regal, particularly the 18-year-old. It can be an excellent blended scotch. In fact, I'll probably be reviewing it shortly. And in order to have that continuity, it's very easy for distillers to become reliant on a particular malt because its personality within the blend is so strong. And that applies really with Longmorn. Longmorn, as I said, is what the blenders call a dressing malt. Now, in the old days, when you would, if you went in and looked at the in the offices of the whisky brokers, you would find that certain casks of single malt commanded a much higher price than others, for the simple reason that they were very highly desirable to blenders as having the character and the personality in the malt of evening out the other malts in a blend, adding a bit, and just generally lifting the overall quality. And two single malts were particularly successful at that. That's Glenrothes and Longmorn. It's what the blenders call a dressing malt. So they realise just a small proportion of this malt in their blends would just kind of enhance the whole quality of the experience. It would kind of fill in the cracks left where, you know, between other malts, and basically add to the complexity. So, and it's very much the case now, you know, it's not for no reason that Chivas Regal is such a prominent and in-demand blend these days, partly down to the quality of the principal malts in, you know, that have become part of the character. If you are looking for an official bottling, I'd like to make clear that I will not be reviewing the 16-year-old Longmorn with its designer packaging, its little leather base and its little fancy zinc tag in the neck. What I recommend you look out for, in fact, is the older 15-year-old bottling from the 1990s. This is as good an official bottling as you are going to find anywhere. And this is it. This is what you're looking for. Funnily enough, it's still available out there because you will find that younger whiskies, in any that are produced in any volume, younger single malts, they tend to not fly off the shelves quite as quick as your older single cask stuff. So good luck in your malt mission. See if you can find this. A good investment, not as a collector's item, but good to collect for drinking later. There we go. One reason for these two whiskies being particularly good, is the fact that up until 1994, Longmorn Distillery operated coal fire stills. So they heated the wash stills directly from underneath using coal. Now, the problem with that is it's dirty, dusty. You've got to have experienced guys there watching the stills all the time to make sure that the heat is properly regulated. But the results are that you simply get a richer, denser malt. And it was only in 1994 that they finally switched over to steam-fired stills, where steam coils run around the inside of the stills. And of course, you have a different heating experience. And the best way to explain this to you is if you imagine visiting someone's home and you go in and they've got central heating, they've got hot water radiators, the house will be warm. It'll be well heated. But when you go to a house where they've got a direct fire in the grate, or even better, they've got a firebox or an agar stove, for example, you get this point of direct heat which radiates out. It's a different quality of heat. It's a different kind of heat. It's a heat that doesn't just warm you, it makes you feel cozy. And that's why it's such a shame when Scotch whisky single malt distilleries are no longer direct firing their stills. There are very few who do that. A notable example is Glenfarclas, and my goodness, it shows successfully in the 12, the 15, the 17, the 21 year old. It does make such a difference to that malt. But perhaps some of the new craft distilleries that are opening up in and around Scotland, and there are quite a few at the moment, interesting times, indeed, very interesting times. Perhaps at least one will consider the unique enhancement of direct firing the still, which of course with modern technology has never been easier than it is now. There we are. Anything more I'd like to add? Not really. As you can see, the unofficial gauge, how does Ralphie rate this bottle? How far down has he got with it? As you can see, I've been sipping this, by the way, for several months now before I've got round to reviewing it. But an excellent whisky, Ralphie recommended. Go find malt mates. Half the fun is actually in the searching and discovering. So it's all very well. Can ask people, well, what whisky should I buy next? But in fact, an important part is gaining the knowledge not to ask others, but to know for yourself what you're looking for and where to find it. So good luck in your malt missions, and we'll see you again shortly for Whisky Review 333. It might be a malt, it might be a blend. I haven't decided yet. We'll just have to wait and see. See ya.